Hello everybody and welcome to the second episode of the Leen Eats Paudcast. Back again with the double intro, really making sure that you have that clear roadmap, that clear guide for the episode ahead. In this episode, myself and Paudie discuss all things Challenge 24 once again. Anyone that missed last week's episode, myself and Paudie are taking on all 24 challenges from Challenge 24 over the 40-day period of Lent. Myself and Paudie had our own fair share of struggles with the challenge this week, as you can see from listening to this episode, but it really does paint home that message that if you have your own fitness goals that you're working towards and you fall off slightly, it's never too late to just get back on and get back fighting and get back working towards that long-term goal. Myself and Paudie are also documenting our progress with the challenge each day on Instagram on our private stories. If that's something you wish to look at yourself, make sure to get onto myself on Instagram at Leen Eats or get onto Paudie at Paudrick O'Callaghan. We'll make sure to add you to those private stories. After that, myself and Paudie discussed a few myths that are out there in the health and fitness industry. These myths covered all things weight loss related in terms of calorie deficits. What do they actually mean? We talked about intermittent fasting. We talked about protein powders and how there's a lot of stigma around that. We also discussed overtraining, the no pain, no gain mentality, and Paudie discussed stretching and a few techniques around that and a few myths around that. Myself and Paudie will be getting into everything in more detail in the future, so do stay tuned for that. And we're live. Welcome everybody to the second episode of the Leen Eats Paudcast. I'm your host, Ben Leen Smith, here today with Paudrick O'Callaghan to discuss all things Challenge 24, giving you a bit of an update on how we fared with that in the last week or so. And we're going to cover a few myths that we've discovered in the health and fitness industry. First off, Paudie, we'll address the elephant in the room. What's the story with the name? Where did this podcast name come from? Can we spell the word podcast? Would you like to let the viewers know?
I'm mostly known as Paudie among my friends. So myself and Aidan Cregan, I'll give him a shout out. We started a podcast. Not really a podcast, but it was more a video thing on Snapchat a while back, just kind of to pass the time for the laugh. We posted a few interesting videos, so we just called it the podcast. We couldn't call it the Aidcast, like Aidan Cregan, so we just called it the podcast, and that's where my half of it came, really. And then, of course, Leen Eats, from yourself, from the Insta page, the nutrition page, that's just where it came about, really.
Yeah, everyone might not notice, like, we had a lot of comments in saying, geez, you seem like you've been doing it for a long time, but like, long before the Instagram, long before the podcasts, we had our own Snapchat private vlogs going on for years and years and years. There was plenty of diss tracks to be had, and that really laid foundations for this page. And I remember myself and Paudie, like, we had a bit of beef before, but we've got through it now, and here we are bringing you today the second episode of Leen Eats Podcast. Who'd have thought that? We got into Challenge 24 last week. For anyone that missed that, myself and Paudie are going to get into all the challenges from Challenge 24. We're going to cover them over Lent, so we're about a week into it at this stage. Last week, we were just giving you an idea of where we were at, what we thought of the challenges. I was very bold and saying I thought the challenges were fairly easy, and that was just about getting down to doing them. But I really did get taught a bad lesson that way, I suppose, to not mince my words with that, because I definitely did struggle with a few of the challenges, with even getting to sleep. I couldn't say consistently with going to bed at 10:30 like yesterday. I went to bed at 12. I'm not going to paint this picture that every challenge is easy. Like, it's not like we're going to ace every one of these challenges. Like, it is going to be difficult. There is ups and downs, but it's just about that idea of getting back on it. What did you find was the toughest challenge in the last week, Paudie?
Well, I stuck to all the challenges for the past week, and my sleep's after getting better. That's the main one. The one thing that I did take a break from at the weekend was the cold showers, and I kind of regretted it, because you'd see my day wasn't the best after. For a week before it, you feel like you've accomplished so much after your shower in the morning. And then Saturday and Sunday, I had warm shower, and I just, I felt a bit sluggish then for the day, but I learned my lesson. So I won't be taking a break at the weekends again. That, and I've been getting my 5 a day in every day. I've been getting my 8 hours of sleep in, and my sleep is great. I haven't been reading the David Goggins book for the past week. No offense to him, but I'm not a huge fan of reading, and I just didn't force myself last week, but I'm going to make up for now this week, because I have one of my assignments in, so I'll have extra time, and I'll definitely try and finish it soon.
Yeah, exactly. It is all about like putting your priorities where they need to be as well with this challenge. Like, obviously, if you have college and stuff like that, reading a book about David Goggins isn't going to help you too much with your assignments, other than giving you a bit of mental resilience. Like, I would say with those cold showers, I thought I was having lovely cold showers here in Mallow, like every single day, and I was waking up with cold showers, very refreshing in the morning. It wasn't actually too cold either. And then went down to my college apartment there during the week and turned on the cold shower there. And like, I know you are living at home yourself, Paudie, but anyone that's been in college accommodation just knows it's always very cold, not half as nice as home. Home's always a bit warmer. And I got into that shower and the difference in the cold, like I don't even think Wim Hof knows. That really did set me up for the day. Like, I was straight out of my comfort zone. But like, even as Paudie was saying, like, you can take days off for these challenges, but like, you can get straight back on them too. Would you like to tell us about those smoothies you were doing to get that 5 a day in?
I've done two now. The first one was very nice. I think it was cranberry juice, celery, grapes, apple, and was there a carrot or something? Oh, there was a carrot and there was a tomato. There were tomatoes. That was really nice, surprisingly, especially with the tomato. But then I did an all-green one last Thursday. It was a green pepper. I actually poured it into a green pepper and ate the green pepper raw, which was disgusting because it's the worst pepper. I had celery. I had about half a packet of spinach and kale. And I had a green apple and it was disgusting. Couldn't justify it. Like, I put a bit of water into it. Probably should have gotten some apple juice. I wouldn't recommend that one. I'll be doing another one now, maybe tomorrow. Might post it up on my private story on Instagram. But I'm thinking maybe to do a slightly nicer one. Might put a red pepper into it and might put some broccoli and maybe some blueberries or something. Wouldn't be the worst.
Might have to agree to disagree with you on that there, because I think there's no beating the green peppers, but like, definitely, I'd say by the sounds of that second one, even by looking at it, just sitting in the green pepper is definitely like, put your fingers on your nose and just get it down and just try let it sit, like, but at least you are finding those ways to get around your obstacles, get those 5 a day in. But yeah, even the tomato one, like, it looked very similar to like one of my recipes for making pizza or something. I don't know. It seemed very tomato-y, like, but I'll take your word for it. I can't say I was too good with that side of the challenge in terms of making it interesting. I was just getting it in whatever way I could. Definitely had a few days where I was having dinners where it just wouldn't have made sense to have vegetables, but put vegetables out on the sides. I think I'd sound like steamed Brussels sprouts. Wouldn't recommend it. Not very nice. Doesn't sound great either. In terms of any of the other challenges, just speaking on my own experience, in terms of the book, I got through my book in the last week. I think with what Paudie was saying there, like, it is important that like, you find a book you actually enjoy. You can very much be under pressure to like force yourself to read a book, but if you're not engaging with it in the sense that it's not immediately like captured you after reading it for like a day or two, like, chances are a lot of the time, I know people will say to give a book a bit of a chance, but it can like turn you off the whole reading process. And like, I found with the book I was reading, once you get into it and it kind of clicks and like you can't put yourself away from it, that's when you've got a good feeling with it. And also when the ideas are probably really resonating with you. I was reading 11 Rings by Phil Jackson and he's just getting into Kobe, Michael Jordan. I was talking about this last week, but I actually finished it now. And it's just so interesting to like get an insight into what a successful locker room is like. Myself and Paudie can't really speak on it too much, I suppose, because we're not really in team sports, but like, how like an individual has to sacrifice themselves for a team. I've only seen that a small bit in running. If you've to bring other people on, that's just going to help the whole group in terms of the atmosphere and everything like that. I'm going on a big tangent here. In terms of what you were saying with the David Goggins book though, Paudie, anytime I was reading that, the one thing I took away from it was that man's mindset. And like, he was running some ultra marathon, I think it was the Badwater 100 miler or something like that. And he was just putting himself through absolutely everything. And like, his mentality is really great, and you do learn a lot of great tidbits from it. Like, when going gets tough, like, think about that feeling of when you've actually accomplished a goal. I remember with David Goggins, he was like getting sick and his kidneys had like failed or something along those lines, and there was all sorts of stuff coming out of him. His toes were covering all sorts of blisters and stuff like that. Was there anything you kind of gleaned from looking at the mindset like that when you're reading it?
Well, one big thing from that is just looking at how much he pushed himself in his marathon. I suppose that was his competition. Like, that was what he was working towards. So he gave it his all. If he was to be in that condition training, as we were saying earlier, Joe, you're training to race. You're not racing to train or with any other sport. Like, you're training to compete. You're not competing to train. So if he was to put himself through those grueling conditions in training, there's no way he would have been able to compete at that level and push himself to those limits. So it's all about, so it's going slightly smaller in training and just staying consistent with it so as you can actually take that opportunity to give it your all in the competition. And that's kind of the mindset he was in. you know, his competition was everything to him. So he was willing to break bones or just go through grueling conditions, whatever it takes really to win.
Yeah, exactly. I, like, anytime I read that, his mindset, like, fascinated me in that way. One thing I couldn't get over though was the fact that, like, he'd go into a lot of these races, like, unprepared. And, like, I thought it was great that he had that mindset that, like, he could overcome adversity. And when the going got tough, like, he just got back on it and just kept battling through. But it was, like, the sense that, like, he'd go without training for months and stuff like that. That really stuck with me. And I could see that he had this, like, potential and this talent there. And, like, he had this no pain, no gain attitude. But I used to always wonder if he actually pieced it together. And maybe if he didn't have that attitude the whole time, like, he could have stayed a bit consistent with his training. And this isn't a slight on Dave Goggins or anything. This man's achieved so much that I haven't achieved. But what I'm saying is, like, if he could have stayed more consistent, and we were talking about this in pre-production, like, he really did push himself through all these barriers, but, like, his body broke down a lot because of that. And I think that could have hampered him a lot of way that, like, he wouldn't have gotten the necessary training in to do. And, like, going into the next topic, we were going to talk about some fitness myths. And you were telling me about the myth that is around very much in the powerlifting industry. And it's very much the same in running, even. It's something that I'd been a victim of when I was younger. And that's, like, the no pain, no gain mentality. That, like, if you're not pushing yourself to your absolute limit in training, you're not doing enough. Like, what are your thoughts on that myth?
The human body can't push itself to its extreme, like, to limit every single session. If you're training 4 days a week or 5 days a week, you're not going to be able to give it. You'll be able to give it your all, but to an extent. You're not going to be able to max out every single session. You're not going to be able to run a PB every session. As I just said earlier, as you were telling me as well, the competition is the goal, and your training is just steps towards that goal. So in your training, you don't want to be going flat out all the time. You want to be working on smaller bits and just building up towards that end, just your end goal, really. So with no pain, no gain, there's a myth there that, you know, if your legs aren't dying the morning after a squat session or a running session, that you didn't train right or that you didn't give it everything. But your body shouldn't be hurting that much after a session, because you're more likely to get injured that way. So just give it enough rather than, you know, push it to an extreme.
I even remember, like, in running a lot of the time, especially when I was younger, where I probably wouldn't have known as much about training, I could see that there was, like, a direct link between, like, pushing yourself hard in training and, like, actually making gains of performance. But what I didn't see was, like, when you needed to go off the boil with training a bit. And I remember going out on, like, what were supposed to be easy runs. Well, my coach would tell me to go for, like, 8 or 9 miles after a hard session. And I used to just turn them into a training session in itself. And I thought, like, I was doing the right thing when I was younger, because all I wanted to do was improve. And my coach would be telling me so much, and I'd say I gave him a lot of headaches with this, to, like, just slow down my runs a bit and not to, like, race every single run and race every single session. But, like, I couldn't, like, stick with that idea. And I really just wanted to improve the whole time. And I remember doing, like, 1 mile repeats the day after a training session, without my coach knowing. This was when I just first started running, and, like, I thought it was benefiting myself. But then you just start getting injured and you just feel tired the whole time, and your performance dips in training. It is really hard to, like, realize that overtraining is a thing. And I know we all have this mentality that, like, we just want to push ourselves, because obviously, like, pushing yourself is a good thing, but there is very much a limit, and you want to just train on the line and not over it. As Dennis Collin was once telling me, you don't want to get injured. You don't want to get sick. You don't want to be tired when you get to training in races. You actually want to execute on the day and actually, like, get the rewards for your training. But it's something a lot of people can get into, especially in the fitness industry, of just pushing themselves the whole time and not really taking the necessary recovery that they need. And that's why everyone does get into, like, these mad recovery techniques where, like, ice baths are great in isolation. But, like, if you're training too hard and your training isn't structured properly, where you have, like, sections of periodization and progressive overload, like, if you don't have a structured training plan, it's not going to work.
So one thing I see in, I suppose, people lifting, because I'd see more people in the gym rather than running. What I see is a lot of people are using a logbook for tracking their sessions, tracking their lifts, the weight, the reps and the set, but they're logging it in after the session. And I used to do that all the time. What I started doing, and I'll tell you the reason why as well, I started writing my session before I do my session. So if I was doing a push session, I'd write out bench press, I'm going to warm up with 40 kg by 8 reps, and I'm going to go to 60 kg for 8 reps, and I'm going to build up, and I'll write down exactly everything I'm going to build up to, including my final set, if that was to be 120 kilo bench for 3 sets of 4 or 3 sets of 5. And I do that mainly because I saw a lot of the time when I was filling in my session as I go, I might feel really good that day and I might go for heavier weight. So I might say, do you know what? I hit this one. So I'm going to go for 130 kg for a few reps. And I'd always find the day after then, whether it be bench or squats or deadlift, that I'm a lot more fatigued because I pushed that extra bit. I know pushing yourself is good, but I did find, and if people want to try it out, I'd highly recommend it, to write your session out beforehand and stick to it. Just stick to it 100%. And then if you want to, say, for your next session that you want to increase the weight, go ahead and do that. But don't increase it last minute, as a lot of people do and as I used to do. I'd say finish your session as you had it written out beforehand, and then the next day increase. I think I've progressed way better doing it that method, so I would highly recommend that.
Yeah, that's a great point. That's actually something I've just taken a lot from there myself as well. I don't think I've ever gone into a strength and conditioning session or into the gym with an actual structured plan. I see so many people going out with there's these apps, I think Strong is one of them, where you can track your lifts and stuff, but you're tracking them on the go. But you do get into the sort of pattern there where you're going into the gym without any sort of plan, and you're just seeing what will I do, what's free now, is the bench free now? And I'd find I'd go in, I'd just keep doing more and more exercises, and especially with lockdown, you'd have an hour and a half or so to be in the gym, and I just make sure I used every bit of that, even though I might not have necessarily needed it. I just keep pushing myself until that time was up or until I was extremely fatigued, so I'd feel like I actually got a benefit from it. But as you were saying, it's that's not going to benefit you in the long run. If you look at the whole cycle of training, it's only going to give you any bit of a short-term benefit. While we're on the topic of weights as well, one thing I definitely see, and I know I could probably pick your brain on this, Paudie, is with runners, particularly when they start getting into weight training and S&C, a lot of them do get this big fear that if I start lifting weights, I'm just going to put on weight, or I'm going to start bulking up, and will this negatively affect my performance? What are your thoughts on that?
Lifting weights alone isn't going to bulk you up. If anything, it'll tone you up. I'd see as well a lot of my friends would be afraid to get into the gym because they think that they're going to just get big and bulky. I've been training for years, and you don't get big overnight. You don't get huge or bulky in a month. It takes ages to do that. It's a lot about what you're eating as well. It's what you're eating and what kind of rep ranges you're doing.
Yeah, exactly. The rep ranges will definitely have a big impact, I'd imagine, on slow twitch muscle and fast twitch muscle fibers, and they play a lot of a role in appearance and stuff like that. But I think you touched on something great there, even with diet, you're not going to bulk up unless you're in calorie excess. That's one question I've gotten a lot, even with protein powders and stuff. People have come to me and said, I wouldn't trust protein powders. You don't know what's in them. Will they make me put on weight? But people do kind of miss the concept of what actually makes you put on weight. And I think that's why a lot of these fad diets come about as well. And you do see people out there, I don't know if you know James Smith, he's a popular personal trainer that's out there. And he does get a lot of hate because he does push a really simple message that doesn't encompass everything in terms of weight loss and weight gain. But at the end of the day, the primary factor that the message he's trying to get across, and primary factor affecting if you're going to bulk up, is if you are in calorie excess. Even if you're trying to lose weight, myself and Paudie were talking about this earlier, you need to make sure you're getting enough protein, and whether protein powder helps you to do that, it's going to be a big help, because if you're losing weight, you're not necessarily just losing fat, you're also losing muscle. In most cases, you are losing muscle as well, and you're losing water weight too. So lifting weights alone can't make you bulk up. So about your diet, and if that's something you're looking to do as well, if you're looking to lift weights to bulk up, you need to make sure you're eating enough food and that you're eating more than you're burning, because that's what causes you to put on weight. And you need to make sure you get enough protein to make sure you're putting on the right weight. With calories as well, that's something I wanted to get into in terms of the diet myth side of things. like calories get a bad rep because obviously they are associated with like weight gain and weight loss, and they're the primary thing that controls that. But like calorie is a unit of measurement basically for like energy. So if you're not getting enough calories, you're not going to get enough energy basically to fuel yourself through training. And that's something that can lead into like overtraining and stuff like that. Like, have you ever had any conceptions about calories like that, Paudie?
Well, I know that when I'm trying to make weight for a competition, the weight class that I compete in is the 93 kilo. And all year round, except for competition, I'm between 96 and 98 kilos. So when I need to get down to 93 kilos, my protein is going to stay the same. Out of all the macros, my protein is the only thing that's going to stay the same, because obviously I don't want to lose any muscle while I'm losing the weight. A lot of it's going to be water weight. A bit of it's going to be fat too, but I don't want to lose any muscle mass when I'm cutting weight for a competition. So like, you want to keep your, as you were saying, you know, it's a lot about calories in versus calories out. If I'm lowering my calories, I'm going to have to adapt my diet to swap some carbs or swap some fats for more protein when I'm losing weight. It's all down to calories in versus calories out. If you want to lose weight, you know, if you're eating 2,000 calories of chocolate or 2,000 calories of chicken, it's still calories in, but it's going to be different weight.
Yeah, exactly. I think the different weight bit there is crucial. Like, that's where you do get into the opposite side of the debate, like where people do slander these personal trainers that like do just say it's just calories in versus calorie out. Like, you need to make sure you're eating the right foods and that like you're not getting any massive nutrient deficiencies as well. Make sure you're getting enough fiber, and as well as that, like obviously you want to have enough protein. I think protein is something that gets a bit overblown too, a small bit, because like a lot of people will find that they're like choosing these high protein based foods, but most people actually do get enough protein in their diet. One thing as well where like protein gets a bad rep for putting on weight or for bulking up for some reason, like I think most people will find if they had a diet that was really high in protein, you're going to find that you probably won't put on weight because you're going to be very full a lot of time. You're going to be very lethargic because protein isn't used as energy. It gets stored as muscle, or else it just gets excreted, and it makes you feel very full. Basically, like if you could have a load of sugar or something that's really high in sugar, like more often than not, you're not going to feel very full after it. And that's where you get into like, it's actually the carbohydrate side of things where they get targeted, because that's not going to make you feel as satisfied after you have it. And that's when you get into like putting on weight and stuff like that. And the whole calorie debate too, I'm not sure if you've heard anything about it, but one thing that was very popular during the week, especially in the nutrition industry, was intermittent fasting. Basically, to keep you up to date with it, Gwyneth Paltrow, she's the actress, but she basically put out this book about intermittent fasting, and I think she said intuitive intermittent fasting, and intuitive eating is something that's come about recently too, but they're polar opposite things basically, because no one's going to intuitively fast really. But she was saying that like, oh, it's been backed by loads of experts and this is going to help you with weight loss or whatever. But like, what have you heard from intermittent fasting, or have you heard much about it, Paudie?
I haven't heard much about it, to be honest. Like, not just the same method as using weight as just eating less calories. You're pushing your first meal further on the day?
Yeah, it's just making it easier to cut calories, really, in the sense that like if you eat later in the day, you're going to be eating less calories a lot of the time because you've already eaten less in the morning. So it's shortening that space where you're actually getting food in. That's why it can work, but it does get pushed as a bit of a scam by a lot of like supplement companies, and a lot of celebrities will be out endorsing it, trying to push some sort of narrative with it. There's nothing magic about it, like especially if you get into performance, if you're training fasted, like I think Paudie can probably speak to this as well, like you're going to feel very, very lethargic and you're not going to perform at your best. And like that should be your main goal, really. Like, weight at the end of the day, like it's just a number on the scales. Like even Paudie was saying earlier something like, if you're 90 kgs and you've got a lower body fat than someone that's 87 kgs, like who looks leaner, who looks fitter? Like, it's about how you feel as well, not just how you look as well, or the number on the scales too. To make everything a bit more lighthearted, I suppose, another myth that Paudie was sharing with me earlier involves stretching and not stretching when you're cold. Do you want to get into that?
I was told in the gym not to stretch when you're cold, and I would trust my coach, so I'd go by that. I've gone by that for the last 2 years since I've been lifting, since he told me. So don't, yeah, apparently if you're stretching when you're cold, then it's more likely going to do more harm. So if you were to take, for example, if you're playing soccer or if you're doing athletics, chances are you're going to be doing a bit of a run, whether it be laps of the track or laps of the field, before you start stretching at all. So what we're always told, and I'd recommend it as well, because I have found, like, I've gotten less injuries doing this, that before you stretch, if you go into the gym, get on a bike or get on a treadmill for 3 or 4 minutes, get your heart rate up, get warm, and then stretch, or else stretch after your session.
Yeah, exactly. That's actually something I didn't properly understand myself, I suppose, before. But, like, it's something a lot of people are inherently doing, but especially if you are lifting weights, it's something to make sure that you do, especially at the moment, I suppose, with lockdown and everything, everyone's at home, everyone's not moving around as much, so you need to get the muscles fired up. But I think Paudie can really speak as well to, like, the importance of having a good stretching routine. You just feel a lot looser in the session, and, like, it can just really help a lot with your recovery afterwards and making sure you can train properly then on afterwards. If anyone else has any myths that they want us to cover or any questions that they have about anything, make sure to send them in. Myself and Paudie will be more than happy to get on it in next week's episode. We'll be back to you again soon anyway to talk about all things Challenge 24. Anything in the health and fitness industry, it'll come to us. We'll have some sort of topic ready. Be sure to let us know what you think of this episode as well. One thing I should say as well is thanks everyone for your support in last week. It really did help us. Thanks. Really does encourage us to keep going as well. So we really appreciate that. If you're watching on YouTube, don't forget to like and subscribe as well, please. Really helps us out. And yeah, hope you all have a great week. Cheers for listening.
Good luck.